Are you able to see my slide?
Yes, Arun. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So those will later join. So far I have explained like basic of crypto and why do we need SGX and what is SGX and all. So now I'll be explaining enclave life cycle. So we know that what is enclave, which is like isolated memory region, which has like separate heap and stack and all, and which is only visible to a processor, right? And the life cycle of EPC is like allocation and deallocation of the enclaves. So this is how it happens. Like there are like four states. One is like empty and creation, initialization, and in use. So when you will be having like a particular part of the code which has to be secured, right? So then you will be initializing, I mean giving a command ecreate. So one more information, like the SGX has like its own commands, its own like commands like ecreate, einit, eremove. So like e is like a enclave, right? So you cannot like execute in some other memory space. Only within the enclave you can execute some commands, right? So when you give a ecreate, then a memory will be allocated within the EPC. There is a special cache within the PRM, right? That has been created, and the which page which has to be secured will be mapped to the cache, and the EEXTEND will does a hashing. And once the EINIT, the enclave has been initialized, only we can do some operations within the enclaves. So how the EINIT will happen? So there is a special enclaves within the processor. So if I am buying an Intel processor, so it will be having a special enclave which is allocated for the processor, like a launch enclave, code enclave. There are multiple enclaves. Like there are some architectural enclaves especially allocated to some works. So the launch enclave, which is accessing launch key and getting the launch key. So the launch key, what it does, and what is the purpose of launch key? So when we are giving an EINIT command, the launch key will start to distribute an EINIT token to the particular enclave, which has been signed using a launch key, right? So once this has been signed using the launch key, then only we can use an enclave, right? We can do some track and we can enter into enclave and do some operations within the enclave. Before that, it's just a normal memory, right? So the EINIT will make a particular cache to the enclave. Now, so far I explained with like a rough theory. It was like quite boring maybe. So maybe we'll see animation. Maybe we'll get some idea. Okay. So here we'll be having like two sessions, right? Like one is a system memory, which is visible to us, and one is a visible to browser, the PRM. So now we are having a code which is in the application, which has to be secured. Okay. Now, this has to be secured. So what you have to do, we have to create an enclave within the EPC. So the ecreate instruction has to be given. Now, a particular page cache will be mapped, right, which will be selected, and EADD, which will map a code and data within the selected region will be mapped within the EPC. After that, we'll be creating a map entry. So we'll be making, which is like valid, and this is a regular page, and there are some bits has to be set within the SGX enclave control structures. And the one more instruction with EEXTEND. What EEXTEND will does? So this will create a hash of the particular page and store it for verification purpose. And next a EINIT. So once the EINIT, so what will happen in the EINIT? As I said, a launch key, right? The EINIT token will be signed with a launch key and the enclave has been initialized. So after the enclave has been initialized, we can enter into the enclave and we can do some operations like attestation and some sealing. There are multiple features. I'll explain this later. And we can do and work around, and we can exit from the enclave. So once we give the E remove, then what will happen? So everything will be erased and becomes empty. So this is what a life cycle overview of the SGX. So this is how the data has been placed into the enclave and removed from the cache. Okay, so this is what like one part of the webinar, like SGX life cycle. And one more stuff. So as I said, like the EPC is like only 256 MB. So we cannot like store like multiple enclaves at a time. So we need to, sometimes we need to like store it back and load it again into the EPCs. Okay, then what is the issue here? So we are having some values like a stored password or something within this EPC. When you store it back to the DRAM again, if that is going to be the same, like visible to everyone, then what is the use of SGX, right? So when you store it back to the DRAM, which is like visible to users, then that has to be encrypted. And when you bring it back to the PRM, then it has to be decrypted, right? So how this has been, this is happening. So let me explain this lesson. Okay. So page eviction mechanism. So the EPC is like filled, then we are going to block a particular page cache from the EPC and store it back to the system memory. And one more thing, we are maintaining a version array here. So initially, when you create an enclave, the version will be zero. So when you store it into memory, system memory, and when you load it back, the version will be updated to one. So there will be like when you load it and store it back, then we will be having some checkpoints, like the hash has been checked, whether we are like loading a correct page, and is anything has been modified, or everything will be checked in the process. So now I am blocking this page now. Now this page becomes invalid, right? Zero. After that, there is a next instruction track. So while the track instruction has been given, so the particular page will be encrypted, and we will be updating the version array. And then the next instruction will be stored at WB, which will get data from
here. Share your presentation. No? It's not visible.
Oh. No, sir. Now, sir.
Yeah, now it's visible. Ma, I can proceed.
Yeah, so okay. So when you want to store a particular enclave page cache in the enclave to the system memory, then which has to be blocked and tracked, which means like we have to encrypt and update a version array. And after that, we have to store it back to the system memory. So system memory will be having some security infos, which is like with PCMD, like paging crypto metadata. So which will be having like using which key it has been encrypted. So there is a special key for each enclave, which is called seal key, right? For sealing, right? Sealing means like packing. Okay, so we'll be having a special key for each enclave. So using that seal key only will be encrypted and stored. Okay, this is the next process will be loading again to the EPC. Okay, now the encrypted page has been system memory. Now we are going to load it back to the EPC. So first of all, we have to do the verification. So whether it has been like stored back recently. After that, we have to decrypt it with the same seal key and load it back to the enclave and again reinitialize the map values. Okay, yeah, that's it. So this is like half of the session has been over, like the overview of the SGX and how the page evasion has been happened. So how the confidentiality has been maintained within the secured memory region has been completed. Now I'm going to explain what are the keys that we are using within the SGX. It's quite tough and like it'll be like you need some patience to understand this. Okay, so we know that once the key has been compromised, everything will be spoiled. Then how do you create a keys? So there are like two root keys within the processor. When you get a processor, there will be like two keys which has been e-fused within the processor. So one is a provisioning key and one is the seal key. So the provisioning key will be used for attestation. So I'll explain later, like what is attestation and all. And the one more thing is a seal key. So as I said, like the seal key we'll be using is like for encryption, and the launch key will be also derived from the root seal key. And there is a report key which is used for a local attestation. Okay, and like what is the two different root keys? One is a root provisioning key and one is the root seal key, right? So the root provisioning key, which Intel knows, so because Intel is giving a processor, when it's manufacturing a processor, like okay, it knows this processor has this root provisioning key, right? But it doesn't store a root seal key. So only a platform, I mean only within the processor only we know a seal key. Okay, so the root provisioning key will be known to Intel, but the root seal key won't be known to the processor. And we'll be deriving some keys like launch key, seal keys and report keys from the root seal keys, and some other keys, provisioning key and provisioning seal key, from the root keys. Okay, you may ask like why are we having this many keys? So each keys will have like its own specific like use and it has some access restrictions as well. So as I said, like we have seen, right, the launch key will be accessed only from a special architectural enclave, a launch enclave, right? This is how like the provisioning key is, right? So like every enclave in the processor cannot access the provisioning key as easy. So like there are some processes to get the provisioning key from the processor itself. Okay, so let me explain like what are all the architecture enclaves within the processor and the key and enclave relationship. So we'll be having some special enclaves, a launch enclave. So it has some specific work, which is like distribute E init token. So which helps to initialize the enclave and which can only access to the launch key and sign the E init token using the launch key. And there are like provisioning enclave. So which is responsible to get the attestation key. So what is the attestation key? So if some third party is coming and asking whether my application is running in a legitimate platform. So you have to prove yourself like, yes, I am running in a trusted platform. So how will you say that? So our certificate, I mean the processor's certificate has to be signed with the attestation key. Right, so the provisioning enclave will take care of getting the attestation key from the Intel. Okay, and there is a one more enclave, the provisioning certificate enclave, so which can only access the provisioning key and sign this process certificate. Each Intel processor will be having a certificate that has to be signed with provisioning key. Then this certificate has to be given to the Intel provisioning center, then only the server, then only they will verify that okay, this is a legitimate Intel server, then it will provide attestation key to him. Okay, and there is a one more enclave, coating enclave. So when the third party will be asking for the confirmation or validation, then we have to send a particular quote. I mean, it's like another form of report. So that report has to be signed with the attestation key, right? Once the attestation key has been received from the provisioning server, then the report will be signed using attestation key and send it to the third party. So, okay, it may be confusing. So I will explain with the flow later. So the major trust of the SGX is like the root provisioning key and root seal key. And we have like four derived keys, and each keys will be having a specific purpose, and like only some enclaves can only access to this. So if the root, so if the root keys are compromised, then everything gets compromised. So how the root keys can get, I mean, can be compromised. So once you get a physical access to the system, then only you can get the root keys, because which are defused within the processor. Okay. So what is the features of the SGX? So the one of the features which I have already explained, like sealing, right? So we are encrypting the data when it has been placed outside the, actually it's a little bit noisy. Yeah, thanks. So sealing is one of the feature. So when the enclave page, the enclave data which has been resides outside of the EPC, then it has been encrypted using the seal key, right? Yeah. And the another one is the attestation, which is kind of digital signature. So we need to prove a third party to that enclave is running in a legitimate platform and it has not been tampered, right? And there are two types of attestation. One is a local and a remote. Okay, what is a local attestation? Okay, so we are having let's assume like we're having a processor, and within the processor, we're having like multiple applications. Each applications will be having some enclaves. So there is a one application, the enclave of the one application wants to verify that enclave of the another application within the same processor. So which is like local, right? Locally, we have to prove that. So the local attestation. So local attestation needs only a report key, which is within the processor, which has been derived from the seal key, right? Yeah. And another one is a remote attestation where a third-party server involves. So we need some specific enclaves to do that, because like simply we cannot give a report to the third-party user. So we have to contact the code enclave. The code enclave will contact the provisioning certificate enclave, and there are some processes will happen and get the attestation key. Then after that, sign a particular report with the attestation key and send it to the server. So this is how a remote attestation happens. But the remote attestation flow is like quite tedious. Yeah, I'll explain. So let's see the animation of the local attestation within the same processor. So enclave A and enclave B. Now enclave B wants to verify the enclave A. So send enclave B's identity as for enclave A's identity. Now enclave A is here, right? The A will request for the report key. So there is a special instructions to get, I mean, a derive a report key from the root seal key. So once the report key has been generated and given to enclave A, the report will be signed, which means encrypted, using a report key and send it to enclave B. Now enclave B can request the report key from the processor, and enclave B can verify that enclave A is trusted. So it is like you can, if you remember that the signature concept, it'll be easy. And the remote attestation, before you need to know the remote attestation, you need to know like what are the keys and where it has been stored and how the key flows are there. Okay, so when the Intel is manufacturing a multiple processors, so it has to assign keys to each processors, right? So there is an Intel key generation function, right, there within the Intel. So the Intel provisioning key and seal key will be efused within the drive, and at the same time they will be storing it in Intel provisioning service, right? They are making a copy of the processor ID and the Intel provisioning keys also in the Intel provisioning service, right? And they will be sending that to Intel attestation service as well. So when it has been manufactured, the key will be used there and it will be stored in Intel provisioning service server, I mean the server, and the Intel attestation server as well. And when the Intel the remote attestation happens, the coding enclave come into the picture and request for the attestation key. So the attestation key only we can get it from the Intel provisioning service. So how the Intel provisioning service server will identify that, okay, he is a processor which has been manufactured in the Intel. So the provisioning enclave which sign his certificate with a provisioning key and send it to the provisioning service. Once this has been verified, they will give the attestation key, and the signed attestation key, I mean the signed report will be, so we will say a signed report, the attestation key signed report as a code that will be sent to an Intel attestation service to verify. Okay, this is like a key management, like while manufacturing, how this has been stored. So this is like, okay, it's quite complex flow. Okay, let's follow the numbers. Now, there is a third party server, right? So third party server can access to the Intel attestation service. Okay, we know that Intel attestation service will be having a provisioning key. Okay, and the server is, the server is request a processor that whether my application is running in a legitimate platform. So the coding enclave come into the picture. So the coding enclave will get the report from the enclave, and the report of the enclave has been encrypted. So we have to decrypt it using the seal key. So request for the report key and get the report key after the report has been decrypted. Now this report has to be signed using an Intel attestation key. So as I said, getting Intel attestation key is itself a tedious process. Yeah. So the coding enclave will request for the attestation key to the provisioning enclave. Now provisioning enclave will request for a certificate. Yes, please give me the certificate of the particular processor, I mean current processor, signed by a provisioning key. So now the provisioning certificate enclave will do that for us. So get the provisioning key and sign it and give it back to the provisioning enclave. Now we know that provisioning enclave is responsible to get the attestation key from the Intel provisioning service server. So it send it a certificate signed by provisioning key, and once this has been verified, the attestation key will be provided. Okay, now this attestation key will be encrypted using some other key. Okay, that's fine. And now enclave, the coding enclave will get the attestation key. Okay, now we have a report and we have attestation key. So just sign it using attestation key and send it to the server. Now a server can verify it using an Intel attestation service. Okay, now, so I hope that, I mean, it's like very rough and like very hard topic to understand. And you may ask like, okay, if everything has been changed to Intel processor and SGX has been attached, then attacks will be reduced. As I said, only software attacks can be reduced. Still, we have some hardware attacks. So like the Intel SGX has been reduced in 2016, and the attacks has been started from 2017. Like there are like multiple attacks. So it's a recent attack, which is enclave attack. So what the attacker does is like he's executing malicious code within the enclave itself. Yeah, like we trust the application, and we trust the developer that okay, he will be like only executing a trusted pods in the enclave. But the attackers make the processor to execute a malicious and virus code within the enclave itself. Yeah, and some of the attackers like try to get SGX RSA keys which has been derived, not a root keys, which has been derived from the root keys, trying to get the RSA keys. And another attack is like getting the attestation keys, right? And like if we get the attestation keys, then we can masquerade, right, as a legitimate processor. And still some more attacks like cross stack, like getting some leak, information in the interface. So like when we are storing it in a enclave and load it back, some the interface implementation has some loopholes to get the values. Yes. And there are some limitations still in SGX. Like we know EPC is like totally limited to 128 MB. So it's really small. And so if you see, if we want to prove if Amazon is having like Intel processor for applications, right? Now, if Amazon wants to prove a other third-party vendor that I am trusted, then it has to get the key from the Intel, right? Now, Amazon has to get a key from the Intel. It's like, it's weird, because which means like Intel knows then Amazon data, right? Yeah. So still, we are trying to remove, SGX, the Intel team is like trying to remove this third-party attestation. So if the Amazon is having a SGX processor, then Amazon has to have an attestation service as well, right? And the SGX, Intel SGX processor are like very costly, and Intel team is like hardly working to reduce the attacks over SGX. Yeah, so there are some limitations. So yeah, finally we are at end. And one more thing, it is not a brief introduction to the SGX. It's just a quick introduction to the SGX. Yeah. So it has like lots and lots of research opportunities. Yeah. If you guys have like a idea to do masters or some do research intern somewhere, like it's really helpful to you. And if you start to read some papers or some blogs with this knowledge, then it'll be quite easy to understand. And career opportunities in security field, yeah, it's really limited, because in every office we'll be having like a security team, but I'm not sure, like only few people will be there. Just gain experience and try to get a job in security. Like security is like really interesting and enjoyable, and you can enjoy and work in security. Yeah. So, and if you have any questions, then you can ask me in like this mail ID, like amitrajanarun@gmail.com, and you can contact me and connect me with me in LinkedIn, Arun Amitrajan. So I will share this PPT with Maniraj sir, maybe he will share with you. Thank you.
Okay. If you have any queries, you can post in chat box.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation, and we are yet to know about the SGX platform, that many of them not known about it. And we flow of security features, types of attacks they explained was good. Thank you for your wonderful timing, and I thank all the participants for joining. And I regret that we cannot admit some participants due to some technical issues. So hope it will not happen in the future. Thank you. And feedback form I have given in the chat, you can fill it up. Thank you.
Thank you. And
any queries you can post in chat box.
Yeah, actually Kanimali has asked like research topic. So actually SGX itself is a new research domain, like yeah. So the cloud security with SGX probably like a recent research one, like most of the organizations trying to incorporate SGX Intel with them, right? So like a cloud security with SGX is a recent trending research in SGX. So you can explore on it. Any other queries?